the kidney, each kidney has an upper pole and a lower pole. There is a hilum, which allows structures to pass in and out of the kidney. Generally speaking, the structures are a vein and then an artery, and posteriorly it is the pelvis of the ureter. So vein most anteriorly, the renal vein, then the renal artery, and then the pelvis of the ureter in this sequence from before backwards. The hilum of the kidney is located almost at the level of the transpyloric plane, but you should keep in mind that the right kidney is located a little bit lower than the left kidney, again because of the presence of the bulk of the liver that pushes the right kidney a little bit down. The upper pole of each kidney is related to a suprarenal gland. The right suprarenal, as you can see here, is triangular in shape. The left suprarenal is almost crescentic in shape. The left kidney is related superiorly to the stomach, suprarenal, and the spleen. And below, it is related to the small intestine here. And at the region of the hilum, it's also related to the pancreas, the region of the body and tail of the pancreas. On the right side, here there was the duodenum, the second part of the duodenum, related to the hilum of the kidney. And below there is the part of the colon, is related. And of course, here is the liver. The abdominal aorta, you can see that it has a lot of branches. Some of these branches are anteriorly located and others are located laterally. Of the anterior branches, this is the celiac trunk and the superior mesenteric artery. The superior mesenteric artery, again, this artery lies at the transpyloric plane at the level of L1. And you can see here that it almost lies at the level of the hilum of the kidney, the superior mesenteric artery. And you can see here that it passes in front of the left renal vein. The left renal vein, note that the left renal vein that drains into the inferior vena cava is longer than the right renal vein, because the inferior vena cava is not a midline structure. It is located a little bit to the right, pushed a little bit to the right. And so the left vein is longer than the right vein. The left vein passes in front of the aorta to reach the kidney and the hilum of the kidney, and then it lies in front of the left renal vein. So when they reach the hilum of the kidney, the vein is in front of the artery. The renal vein is in front of the renal artery. Note that the left renal vein receives two other veins. It receives the left suprarenal vein and receives this vein. This is a gonadal vein. In this case, this is a female, so it receives the ovarian vein. This is the ovarian vein. So the left ovarian vein and the left suprarenal vein drain into the left renal vein. And this is not the situation on the right side. On the right side, the right renal vein does not receive these tributaries, because as you can see here, the right gonadal vein drains directly into the inferior vena cava, as well as the vein of the suprarenal vein, the right suprarenal vein. Actually, the right suprarenal vein is very short and enters directly into the inferior vena cava. Of the other branches of the aorta is this inferior mesenteric artery, and this lies at the level of L3. And then the abdominal aorta bifurcates at the level of L4 here. And you can see that the inferior vena cava extends more distally than the aorta. So the inferior vena cava is formed at a distal level, at a lower level, at the level of L5. And that's why in sections at the level of L4, for example, usually these sections pass through the umbilicus, although the umbilicus is not a reliable surface anatomical landmark. But a section at the level of L4 will show you the bifurcation of the aorta into two common iliac arteries, but will show you a single inferior vena cava. It has not. It will not show the common iliac veins, the section at the level of L4 vertebra. Of the other branches of the abdominal aorta are branches from the side. Some of them are visceral, like these, the renal arteries. And renal arteries, again, they pass behind the renal veins when they enter into the hilum of the kidney. These renal arteries, they provide suprarenal arteries, what we call the inferior suprarenal arteries, although they are not shown in this model, but they provide inferior suprarenal arteries. In fact, the suprarenal glands are, each suprarenal gland has three sources of arterial supply. The superior suprarenal that comes from the inferior phrenic artery, the middle suprarenal comes directly from the abdominal aorta, is not clearly shown here in this model, and the inferior suprarenal that comes from the renal arteries. And although they have three sets of arteries, they are the suprarenal glands, each suprarenal gland is drained by a single vein. The left suprarenal vein drains into the left renal vein, and the right suprarenal vein drains directly into the inferior vena cava. The renal arteries are generally, they are located at the level of lower border of L1, L2 vertebra. The other branches of the abdominal aorta are gonadal arteries, the left and right gonadal arteries, and these extend down into the pelvis, and this is in a female model. This is an ovarian artery. In a male, the testicular arteries will go down into the inguinal canal to reach the testis, the testicular arteries. The origin of these gonadal vessels from the posterior abdominal wall indicates the embryological origin of these gonads and their descent afterwards. So as they descend, they will drag their blood supply, nerve supply, and lymphatic drainage with them. The abdominal aorta bifurcates into, at the level of L4, it bifurcates into common iliac arteries, and each common iliac artery then bifurcates into an external iliac and internal iliac. And you can see here that at the site of the bifurcation of the common iliac artery, it is crossed superficially by the ureter. This is the ureter extending down from the renal pelvis. And the ureters, as you can see, they are crossed by the gonadal vessels. In fact, the ureters also receive some small branches from the gonadal arteries to supply them. There are multiple arteries that supply the ureter. One of the sets of these arteries come from the gonadal arteries. Of the other branches of the abdominal aorta that we can see here are parietal branches, like these. These are lumbar arteries. Usually there are four lumbar arteries, because the aorta actually bifurcates at the level of L4, so there are four lumbar arteries. They supply the wall of the abdomen, and you should not forget that they also send radicular branches to the spinal cord and the cauda equina. Another parietal branch is this one, is the median sacral artery. And you cannot see the origin of this median sacral artery, because this artery arises from the back of the abdominal aorta just before its bifurcation. Median sacral artery goes down into the pelvis and participates in the blood supply of the pelvis. Like the internal iliac artery is also supplying the pelvis, while the external iliac artery extends down beneath the inguinal ligament to continue into the lower limb and becomes the femoral artery. Of the muscles that we can see here, apart from the diaphragm, the crura of the diaphragm, you can see here the psoas major muscle. This is the psoas major muscle. And you notice that psoas major muscle is related anteriorly, it's related to the kidneys. So if we go back to the relations of the posterior aspect of the kidney, the upper part will be related to the diaphragm, while the lower part medially is related to the psoas. And then just lateral to the psoas, the other muscle is quadratus lumborum muscle. And then the transverse abdominis. So this is the transverse abdominis here that continues onto the anterior abdominal wall, while quadratus lumborum extends from the 12th rib to the iliac crest, and medially it is attached to the transverse processes of lumbar vertebrae. So here we have the three muscles, the psoas, quadratus lumborum, and transverse abdominis muscle. Again here, the psoas, quadratus lumborum, and transverse abdominis muscle. This muscle here is the iliacus muscle, which is present in the iliac fossa. This is the iliacus muscle, and you can see here that the iliacus will join the psoas to form a common tendon, the iliopsoas, that passes beneath the inguinal ligament again and is attached to the lesser trochanter of the femur. But the iliacus is not attached to the spine. Superiorly, it is not attached to the spine. But the psoas is the muscle that is attached to the spine. Regarding the veins, we have just mentioned that this is the inferior vena cava. This part of the inferior vena cava has been cut because it was included with the detached liver. And this is the continuation of the inferior vena cava that passes through the central tendon of the diaphragm. Here, the inferior vena cava is shown to receive the renal veins. Again, I repeat that the left renal vein is longer than the right renal vein because the inferior vena cava is a little bit to the right side. And the inferior vena cava receives the right gonadal vein, not the left, because the left gonadal vein goes to the renal vein, to the left renal vein. The inferior vena cava receives the right suprarenal vein because the left suprarenal vein does not drain directly into the inferior vena cava, but it drains into the left renal vein. Here, this shows the formation of the inferior vena cava. It is formed below the level of the bifurcation of the aorta. It is formed at the level of L5 by the union of the two common iliac veins. Each common iliac vein is formed by the union of the internal iliac and the external iliac vein. And again, the external iliac vein is the direct continuation of the femoral vein beneath the inguinal ligament. The upper pole of the kidney is related to the diaphragm. And behind that, it is definitely related to the ribs and the costodiaphragmatic recess of pleura. So the upper pole of the kidney is related to the 11th and the 12th ribs here. And you will remember that the lower border of the pleura is located at the level of the 12th rib, just posteriorly, just lateral to the vertebral column. So that's why surgical procedures on the kidney might injure the pleura because of the relation of the upper pole of the kidney to the pleura. Now, where the ureter crosses the bifurcation of the common iliac artery, this is a site of normal narrowing of the ureter, where a stone might get impacted here at the site of the crossing. The other site of narrowing of the ureter is located at the pelvi-ureteric junction, at the beginning of the ureter here. And the third common site is where it passes into the urinary bladder.